It's indeed an honor to give the Burke Lecture at the college's main meeting. I'd just like to point out a few things about Dr. Burke. He graduated from Wharton, went to Jefferson's Medical School, and actually served in the U.S. military in World War II. He made very distinguished contributions, as well as those that he did in gastroenterology, including co-authoring the gastroenterology textbook with Henry Bacchus. He was the founding chair of medicine at UCI and founding chair of gastroenterology as well. Truly a distinguished contributor to our field, and it's indeed an honor to be able to talk about something that's near and dear to my heart, which is endoscopy in the near future. This is basically my opinion. There's not much data, obviously, about the future. So the objectives will be to understand how quality metrics will influence endoscopic procedures, how to attain the best training for those procedures, and three important areas to develop for future endoscopic practice, at least the way I see it. So when one thinks about endoscopy in the future, one can think about this as components to an endoscope. At the umbilical cord, we have the pairs, the sources of all change, and we'll talk about that in some detail. We have the control handle, mainly us, the endoscopists. We learn new techniques, as well as improving upon the old. And finally, the insertion tube, which are the targets for innovative technologies. There's a number of payer pressures on endoscopy right now. We're all familiar with the Affordable Care Act, value modifiers, the final rule of the MACRA, the Medicare Access, and the Children's Health Insurance Program Reauthorization Act was passed, and the final rule, all, I think, 2,700 pages of it is now available as of last Friday. And in it, it describes alternate payment methods and also merit-based incentive payment systems. The APMs in particular are rather nebulous in their initial proposal, and now they've been finalized. One thing we have to keep in mind is this isn't exactly being done for our benefit. The overall objective for the MACRA is to save $4 billion a year for the next 10 years. It's actually $39.5 billion, but I'll spot them the $500 million. Data collection begins January 1st, 2017. That's not very long. They've actually got a whole series of plans. If you don't do anything to collect data next year, you'll take a 4% penalty the following year. If you do something, they'll make it neutral. And if you collect everything, they'll give you a 4% bonus. So they are trying to make this work, but you can delay collection of data as late as October, although everything's due in 2018. So all of these things emphasize quality payment plans. The merit-based incentive payment system combines all those things we had before, which includes the PQRS, the value-based payment modifiers, the electronic health record incentive programs into one. So in other words, they made a mess of it again. There's four major components: quality, research utilization, advancing care information, and practice improvement. They realized that resource and utilization would be very difficult to collect in the first year. So in the first year, they're taking it out. But that means quality performance will be 60% of the MIPS formula. So quality is definitely on the minds of our government and will be affecting our reimbursement. The rest you can read there. Of course, they're waiting all the other things, security of information, all the database things, fairly significantly. Practice improvements waiting about 15%. And you can see what the MIPS payment adjustments are going to do over time. By 2019, you'll have the plus 4, minus 4% possibilities. But once you hit 2022, it'll be plus 9, minus 9%, depending on how compliant you are and how well you use your resources. So this is all coming, right? And we always feel that We hope that the government gives us a nice strategy for the future, a bus to take us to that ideal destination. Instead, we always end up with like a kludge of everything that's happened before that, you know, Lord knows how it moves, but somehow it does. So these advanced alternative payment methods that were clarified, I didn't put these in your handout because they weren't available at that time. But now we kind of know what they look like. You have to be participating in electronic health record, and they're defined as the next generation ACO models. If you're interested, they're on the CMS website. There's 18 nationally. In our area in Minnesota, for instance, the Park Nicollet Clinic is one of these next generation ACOs. All of them involve increased risk. The Medicare Shared Savings Program that you're all familiar with, track 2 and 3s, are all risk sharing strategies that the government is using. So they give us a little bit of cheese, but we have a big trap ahead of us. But what can we do about that? Well, quality is being emphasized by the government. It takes a long time to implement a quality measure. This just shows you the timeline, roughly about 4 years between proposal and actual effect on reimbursement. And they did make it so that MIPS do not have to be consensus endorsed like they had before, which used to be a real pain getting it through PQRS and stuff like that. But they have to be evidence-based using databases such as these that they have on their website, all kinds of things. What I would encourage all of you to do is think about how you can influence this process. And how can you do that? There is nothing to prevent us from using GIQuick, our endoscopic database, to supply this information for these measures. As you know, it's a combined effort of both the college and the ASGE to develop reasonable GI-specific outcomes, things that we can control rather than having some outcomes-based group decide what seems to be reasonable for them. And I also encourage you to support, as the college has, high-quality research to provide the evidence to construct these measures. Now, that's my pitch for what you can do for databases. Next, I want to talk a little bit about proposed training. How do we learn? This also needs your efforts. If you think about in the past, endoscopy was an apprenticeship model. You basically learn by watching your mentors and off you go. But we can't afford to do that in the future. We probably will need new educational models, focused skill acquisition. There are no current standards of training for endoscopic procedures. Competency is largely self-determined. And no certification really is available on how well you do procedures. There are many simulation models in existence. Some that are very realistic, like the GI mentor systems. Some test specific skills, such as the box simulator, just in manipulating the tools. Some are latex models. And of course, we always have used animal models to simulate GI procedures. And this is just an example of the GI mentor system, very realistic, fairly expensive. There are other systems such as this AccuTouch out there. This shows you the status of simulation endoscopy. And I have to say, I came away from an NIH conference on simulation thinking about what they asked us. Why don't we use this more? Why are we not training more rather than using patients? And if you look at the status, there is not a lot we have that's actually been validated. You can see these in the green boxes, and most of them are for novices. Not many for advanced procedures other than a few ex vivo models. But we'll talk about that. I think we need to push this in the future because procedures have gotten too difficult to just learn by watching one or two, or worse yet, downloading YouTube videos and figuring we can do the same thing. One thing you have to keep in mind is surgical training already depends on simulators. Now, we don't know if it's actually valid to do so, but it's already required by the American Board of Surgery, who has a flexible endoscopy curriculum, or the FES. And computer simulators form a great part of that. One thing nice about the simulators, they will allow assessment of skills in a uniform fashion that we've lacked before. And it's something I think you, as the future of endoscopy, need to consider, because groups are going to want to know how well you do. We're using surrogate metrics now, but I think we have to think about doing something like that in the future. So we might evolve from being the man to some kind of simulated machine in the future. What can you do? I think you can participate in these courses that result in certifications, like the ASG STAR program that assesses baseline knowledge. Endoscopic skills are taught in simulators, such as pig models and so forth. And there are post-course logs. And finally, there's an evaluation of the acquired skills. Now, we don't like being evaluated, no one does, but I think it's important that we show evidence that we are competent in what we do. That's going to be a demand, I think, in the future, and that's what we're talking about. Lastly, how about components of endoscopy in the future? Targets. One nice thing is that endoscopy is a big market, and there's a lot of innovation going on. Even at this meeting, if you go in the exhibit halls, you can see new endoscopes, 360-degree visualization. There's a lot of movement going on, and I think that's very positive for our field and something we need to encourage, because without this innovation in tools, we're going to stagnate. In the past, we talked about endoscope of the near future. Control handles that are more ergonomic. How many of you have repetitive use injury to your hands from doing multiple procedures? Who have arthritis? Look, there's quite a few. Why haven't we changed this? We all kind of complain about it, especially once we've mastered it. Well, you know, when you start, anything you use is fine. But later on, you begin to question, why are we using the same devices we did 30 years ago that we know result in injury? And they have developed these, but they haven't implemented them because, you know, they take a focus group, everybody likes what they have. Imaging improvements, like I talked about earlier, now we're seeing behind folds and so forth, and eventually therapeutic platforms are being improved as well, where we got off angle. Why is it so hard to take off a polyp and so forth? Because you only have one direction you're coming at it. If we had another arm to lift, it'd make things tons easier. So these are being developed. Now, this isn't an ad for this company, but it's recently approved by the FDA, and it does exactly these things. It's amazing. So this is within that 2020 time frame. It's just been approved. This is a propulsion assist device, joystick steering. This is actually the steering handle for this device. It uses your whole hand instead of just little knobs. That seems to make a big difference. It has 360-degree viewing, and it has two channels for therapy, and you probably heard about this. The insertion tube arm of this is disposable. So, you know, I'm not saying this is what we will be using, but I think this device thinks about some of the things we've done and tries to innovate upon that, something we need to do. And this just shows you how it works. It was originally designed to be a self-propulsion device for endoscopy. It occludes the rectum and actually infuses air. And there's another balloon towards the tip. Once again, now you have the propulsive force where you need it, at the tip of the scope rather than at the end of the insertion tube. So you decrease a lot of discomfort as you propel through. 360 visualization, and also it has, like I mentioned before, two separate biopsy ports and a joystick steering mechanism. That's been approved already. So I think these technologies are there, and I think we should at least investigate to see how well it's going to work in our practices, because without this kind of innovation, we're kind of stuck with the same control handles we've been using for years that we know is kind of awkward. Now, for the three targets I think we should move towards in the future, I picked out these three. This is just my own biases, but I think it's something that will have impact within the next 5 years. Submucosal endoscopy, moving below the surface. We've been hearing a lot of talks about POMS, about STIR, so-called submucosal tunneling. That's a space we haven't gotten into, but it's easily accessible to us, and there's therapeutic interventions. Structural imaging, looking at endoscopic pathology, and we'll talk about that a bit. You know, actually working as a pathologist. This is going to be a battle in the future with who gets the resources. We've always been sending those biopsies to pathology, even recognizing they're not adding that much to the care of the patient. And I think it's time that this is an area where we can develop to make treatments more cost effective for patients. Bariatric endoscopy, we all know the nation's increasing in size, and now there are approved devices that are endoscopically placed, as well as ways of reshaping the stomach that allow us to reduce weight. Band EMR has been here for quite a while, and actually gets you into the submucosal space. Just by doing a band, you've opened up that area, and you can actually put an endoscope into it. Submucosal dissection is a tool that has been done in the United States. There are certain centers, including my own and Ken's, that we are doing these procedures now, but it requires a great deal of expertise and a limited number of patients are available that this is suitable for. But if you look at literature mainly from Asia, this is a meta-analysis, 90% en bloc resection rates, though stenoses and perforations are a significant complication of this. This is from a paper that was published by Jay Pashrika looking at endoscopy below the surface or submucosal tunneling and the possible applications. But basically what you can do, you can remove the lesions on top by tunneling underneath. That's pretty much endoscopic submucosal dissection. But other things you could do is implant drug therapy. Could this be another device to use in the armamentarium or diseases like IBD? You can diagnose diseases as well. You can find the myenteric plexes and biopsy them for diagnosis of achalasia. You can put monitoring devices down here, and you can put in tissue implants, stem cells, as well as chemotherapeutic agents below the surface. I think all this is going to come about in the next 5 years. A lot of efforts are being made in this area. And then one has to think about, well, how about full thickness resection? Why should we just stop at the mucosal layer? All of us were trained that this is like the major thing. Do not violate the integrity of the GI tract. But we're doing that now. There are full thickness resection methods that are being practiced by some of our colleagues. And they come in two different forms. Resect the lesion first and then close it, like with overstitch, and there are some other devices that were used early on. Or closure first, seal the lesion off, and then cut. And that's very much done with some of the old, especially the anti-reflux device tools, some of which are no longer available, but a lot are. So this just shows you an example of the resection first. You create the perforation, and then you just clip it shut with clips. And that's relatively easy to do, although there is a problem. Once you make the hole, obviously the air escapes the GI tract and you have to be able to visualize, and devices are being constructed to hold this space open while you do this. And the other that sounds more appealing is that you close it first and then resect over the top of it, just like we do now with the endoscopic band ligators. And those devices are being created. This is one such device. It uses a very large, this forceps is actually 2 centimeters when open, that grabs the tissue, pulls it into the cap, which is a almost 4 centimeter long cap to allow you to get both sides of the gastric or colonic wall. You pull the lesion inside, drop a very robust clip, and this is made by the Vesco company, but that clip is much larger than any of those they currently sell in the United States, and then you can resect above the clip. These are technologies that are modifications of what we currently do, so I think they will be eminently acceptable to us, but they actually get all the way through the wall so that we don't have to be limited by the integrity of the GI tract. I also think imaging is very, very important. And this is a statement from the PIVI document that was a challenge to manufacturers to meet, which is basically if you have hyperplastic polyps less than 5 millimeters in size, we need a technology to provide greater than 90% negative predictive value for adenomatous histology. That's been met. We have the meta-analysis performed, and it works. We can reliably distinguish whether or not a small polyp is adenomatous, and now there are numerous studies on the cut, resect, and discard strategy. Narrowband imaging that was used as part of this has been improved. There's new near focus available, 2 to 6 millimeters versus the 5 to 100 millimeters before, and illumination has been increased to 200%. And you can see now that much like the Japanese described years ago, we can see the vascular patterns that's very irregular, as well as irregular shaped glands, in this example of Barrett's esophagus with high-grade dysplasia. This is being done. And the PIVI document criteria has also been met for this with narrowband imaging. I like this study that Prasheek Sharma recently published using the Barrett's International MVI group that establishes a more simpler system for everyone to use to classify dysplasia within Barrett's esophagus. Several systems existed previously, but they were more difficult. This basically just asked the investigators to classify lesions as regular or irregular by 6 experts, and they found pretty good sensitivity, specificity, and accuracy. One interesting finding in this is that, you know, just by saying whether or not it's regular or irregular, and these are all examples of regular pit patterns, you know, you're fairly discriminate in being able to detect dysplastic patterns. And I think that's something we're all capable of doing. Now, it is important that you have high confidence, because if you have high confidence, you can accurately distinguish what these lesions are. And I would say that this study was interesting in that confidence levels, even among experts, varied from 38% to 74%. How do you get to be a high confident expert? I think through good training, like we talked about in the last section. There are ways to enhance our detection abilities. You know, endomicroscopy is now a CPT code. It can be reimbursed. There are devices out there that allow us to look at things at the histological level, such as the volume laser endomicroscopy using near-infrared light. It allows us to see into the submucosal space much better than we have previously been able to do. And you can see this is the device. It sections through 1,200 sections through 6 centimeters of Barrett's esophagus or distal esophagus. Multiple sections are made, and you can look back and forth at all of these to classify lesions. And this just shows you an example. This is done ex vivo. This is Barrett's with high-grade dysplasia, and this is what you can see on these imaging technologies. We're still trying to sort out the precise classification system. In the past, we used the Evans criteria, which looked at loss of layering, heterogeneous scattering, and also a change in subsurface scattering. Now, the last of the areas I think that are very important to focus on is obesity, and this is actually, these guys are wearing hats saying the National Health System in England, and it's being burdened down by the obese English patient, which we know in the U.S., we probably have more obesity than they do in England. We have to do something to treat this, and there is a great endoscopic opportunity for us. Now, the difficulty is, in order to implement these programs, you have to have a structured weight loss program, which most endoscopists don't have. You'd have to work with weight loss centers in your area or develop your own. And gastroenterologists need to create these programs with these counselors, dietitians, and establish these centers in order to implement this. Now, what do we have available? We have endogastric balloons. Now, you have to keep in mind, these are not totally benign. There is a reasonably high incidence of pain, nausea, perforation, and migration with these balloons. There's two that have been approved, the Reshape and the Obera, and also there is an endoscopic suturing solution to this where you can make a double plication as shown in this figure throughout the greater curve of the stomach and create an endoscopic sleeve procedure, much similar to the sleeve procedure done laparoscopically. There's also the Aspire Assist that is available, which is really great if your patient has bulimia. Actually, that's a exclusion criteria, but you know, you suction out what they ate roughly about 20 minutes after they ate. That's what the patient's required to do. The Maestro system is vagal stimulation. That is not an endoscopic procedure, but it is an approved device. And you can see the various balloons here, the Reshape, which uses two balloons, the Obera, which is being placed with the endoscope alongside and inflated. You can see the Reshape actually uses methylene blue, so if any of the balloons burst, they start urinating blue and they can tell you that. And this is the Aspire Assist, where you're actually suctioning the food out of the stomach. Roughly about 30% or so of the calories that they take, you can take out this way. You know, all of these have limitations. Most patients don't tolerate doing this long term. Both the Reshape and Obera are only approved for 6 months of placement. So in summary, I think at this time, what's going to happen? Well, how will the quality metrics influence? Well, they will be part of how we are judged as far as a quality procedure is concerned. There's an emphasis on these outcomes, and I think endoscopists such as ourselves that don't participate in this at the current time need to participate in databases like GI Quick to allow us to assemble the data to control our own future. For the best training, I think we need training that involves not only education and documentation, but also skills evaluation, oftentimes through simulation. And three areas that I think is very important for our future endoscopic practice are submucosal therapies for treating lesions like cancer, imaging to characterize histology, and lastly, bariatric endoscopy. Thank you very much for your kind attention.